Good morning, my dear students. Yesterday I was discussing about the thermal conductivity and the material property. Thermal conductivity with variable in nature, as the temperature increases or the difference in temperature, how the thermal conductivity varies. That I stopped at this point. Now I am continuing from this onwards. That is substituting the value of C1 and C2 in equation 3.2, you get the governing differential, the temperature distribution equation like this, with diffusion, thermal diffusivity as alpha and average temperature as Tm like this. So, the quadratic equation that we are going to get in terms of T, it can be solved by this quadratic equation. So, go to the next slide. So, substitute the value of A, B and C as a temperature distribution, you will get this equation. This is the temperature distribution equation. I think it is very difficult to remember also for any region. To understand all this, it is very difficult. Yesterday, I told you regarding the heat transfer data handbook. You can refer this temperature distribution equation in heat transfer data handbook. Kodan Raman, preferably all the students used to refer. You can also buy the Kodan Raman book and then see this temperature distribution equation in that book. You can directly take from that. So, but you should assure that one should be knowledgeable enough to understand what are the boundary conditions that he has used for deriving that equation. This equation is derived on the basis of the known temperature on both the sides and the conductivity and x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. For this condition, this equation prevails. If the condition temperature is not known at this point, heat flow is not known at this point, then the equation totally differs. Okay, that condition, the equation become different. Hence, the equation 3.3 is the temperature distribution when the temperature of the two sides are known and heat flow through this slab of thickness L is known. So, that is what I written. So, it is very clearly said there that both the side temperatures are known and the heat flow is also known to you, then only you can apply this boundary condition for finding the temperature distribution as well as the heat flow. So, coming to this is the temperature distribution equation. To find the heat transfer through the slab of thickness L in this condition with the known temperature distribution on both the side. So, again, once again, I will write this figure. It won't take much time. X is equal to L. I am repeatedly writing this to make you familiar with that. This is the heat flow and then flowing like this. Q, this is Q, this is T1 and this is T2 with a variable thermal conductivity as 1 plus of alpha T. So, the temperature distribution is already understood and you know that by the Fourier's law of thermal conduction, Q is equal to, can you see this? Yes. Q is equal to minus K A dT by dx. You know already I am telling, keep telling this, you should remember that the rate of heat flow is in the direction normal to the cross-sectional area exposed, which is perpendicular to the board. Cross-sectional area perpendicular to the board at this point. It means that is the area exposed, normal to the surface, cross-sectional area exposed. Okay, from that you are taking the heat flow in this direction. So, this is the Fourier's law of thermal conduction and I have to substitute the K value here, K naught 1 plus of alpha T
dA dt by dx is the value, the heat flow. So this is at x is equal to 0. What is the boundary condition? Is at x is equal to 0. When x is equal to L, again it will be a different equation altogether. You know that dt by dx is equal to dt by dx is equal to, already you derived C1 divided by K0 1 plus of alpha t. Already I have taken this C1 and substituting C1 in this equation. So dt by dx you can substitute in the above equation, and what do you get? Also you can substitute the C1 value, dt by dx is equal to C1 is T2 K K0 by L, K0 by L, bracket T2 minus T1, multiplied by 1 plus of alpha Tm, this is the C1 value, and this is multiplied by again 1 divided by K0 1 plus of alpha t. This is what you have to do it. Substituting this in the equation, and you get the Q value in terms of the variable thermal conductivity. You know that the variable thermal conductivity already given in the equation. The final equation that I am going to get after simplification of substituting all this value, and you will get Q is equal to minus Km, that is the equation is linear, and now plus Km into area T1 minus T2 whole divided by L, where Km is equal to the conductivity average with respect to average temperature 1 plus of alpha Tm. It means at mean temperature we are taking the as the mean conductivity of the substance. Okay, and this is how the heat transfer also can be, heat conduction also can be calculated by using this equation. What you understand from all these things? It means the procedure remains same and derivation remains same. I started with the second order differential equation, second order partial differential equation or in differential equation, the controlling differential equation also, d square t by dx square, and it is taken, and then the Fourier's law of thermal conduction equation is taken to derive the conductivity or conduction heat flow, and also the temperature distribution for the slab in Cartesian coordinate. So in the syllabus it is mentioned that with heat generation, without heat generation, and with variable conductivity, without variable conductivity, problems are given only in Cartesian coordinate, not in cylindrical coordinate as well as in spherical coordinates. That is why I am solving only the slab that is in Cartesian coordinate only. Okay, I'll come to the, I'll go to the next slide. The steady state unidirectional heat flow through a slab of non-uniform conductivity without heat generation. There is another case. What is that another case is not? With a known heat flux we have to take, and then we have to study the equation condition. It means the boundary conditions are the uniform conductivity, the heat generation. This is also unidirectional heat flow through a slab of non-uniform thermal conductivity without heat generation. So there is a case where the Q is a known value. When the Q is known, how do you calculate? By integrating. The other case I am going to take. Similarly, first you have to consider the Fourier's law of thermal conduction, that is Ka dt by dx. You know that for K you have to substitute K0 1 plus of alpha T 1 plus of alpha t that you have to substitute here, and with a cross-sectional area or the area exposed normal to the direction we flow, integrating the above equation, what you get? Q dot x, q multiplied by x minus k naught t plus alpha by 2 t square into a plus c1. You know, the integration of dt by dx is 1, and that is taken care here, and plus c1 is. So using the boundary condition, you know that at t is equal to t1 and x is equal to 0, and I am going to get the c1 value like this, k naught t1, because I am putting the t1. Q dot x is there, that if you substitute, it will be get 0. Now c1 is equal to this value I am going to get. So substituting the c1 value in the above equation, what do you get? Qx minus k naught t plus alpha by 2 t square into a, and k naught t1 plus alpha by 2 t1 square into a. One is unknown temperature, another is a known temperature and heat flow. So you can calculate the unknown temperature here. Okay, this is Q is known to you. That is a known boundary condition. And temperature T1 is a known boundary condition at x is equal to 0. Now you have to calculate the unknown temperature T1. So that is what the second different boundary conditions. This is one of the boundary condition. Previously, known temperature on both the side of the wall is taken. And suppose this condition, if I write for a slab of thickness L, so the Q is known and T1 is also known, but I don't know the value of T2 here, but I am going to take temperature T at the midpoint and thermal conductivity, variable thermal conductivity as K0 1 plus of alpha T. This is the condition I am taking at x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. This is x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L at these two points. So only temperature T1 and Q is taken in the x direction. The flow is in x direction, but T2 I don't know. So in that case, how do you find the temperature? This is one of the conditions to find the temperature distribution at the center with a known heat transfer coefficient. That is what I have taken the effort to derive this equation. So this is again the temperature distribution equation. Again, you have to simplify to get the temperature T. Again, you will get the quadratic equation. Again, you have to solve this. And you have to simplify taking the K0A, the left side, and then take all the unit to the left side in terms of temperature square. That is alpha T by T square plus T, and Q dot X K0A minus of T1 alpha T T1 square. This is a factor A, B, and this whole thing is C. So here I am going to write this as B means 1 minus B, okay, A plus of B minus of 4AC. B is 1 again, coefficient of T is 1 minus 4A, alpha by 2 is A, okay, alpha by 2 is A, and C is QX K0A minus of this, okay, like that I am taking. Because you have to write this equation, this is the quadratic equation in terms of A, B, C, X first. Okay, now coefficient, the A value, B value and C values are taken and then substituted in this equation, and after simplification you will get this equation as diffusivity with the node. What do you find out of this is, you know, the QA is taken as a small Q, that is the heat flux with the variable thermal conductivity K0. All these factors are merged in and we are going to get the temperature distribution, unknown temperature distribution at the any value of X. You know that X value is Q dot X is there. See, at this point of X, you can also, at any value of x means, suppose here I am going to take, this is the value of x. X is equal to 0, x is equal to x means at this point I am going to take the temperature T. See, using this equation I can find the temperature, and also you can take x is equal to L, you will get temperature T2.
x is equal to L in the place of Q dot, x is there. If you take L, you will get the temperature T2. This is one of the useful boundary condition with a known heat transfer at the boundary surface, the left side. So, where Q by A is known as heat flux and temperature distribution. Again, it is getting simplified, simplified, further simplified, you will get the final equation like this. So, this is only a simplification required, and finally you will get temperature distribution T is equal to 1 by alpha plus of square root of 1 by alpha plus T1 whole square minus of 2 heat flux multiplied by 2 in the heat flux into the distance x divided by alpha k0. So this is the equation that I am going to get it. I think I have solved with variable thermal conductivity with two boundary conditions. What are the boundary conditions which I have taken? For this is x is equal to 0 and t is equal to t1, this one boundary condition, x is equal to L, t is equal to t2, this is the first boundary condition. The second boundary condition that I have taken by considering the minus ka dt by dx is the Fourier's law of thermal conduction equation, q is equal to, here q is known at x is equal to 0. Q is known at x is equal to 0, and also at x is equal to 0, T is equal to T1. This is the boundary condition I have taken, and there are two cases. This is case 1, this is case 2. In both the cases, I derived the temperature distribution equation as well as temperature distribution equation. For a slab of thickness L, and also the heat flow, rate of heat flow. You can write heat flow through the slab. Slab of thickness L. Slab of thickness L. So these two conditions satisfy the temperature distribution as well as heat transfer. Okay, go to the next, that unidirectional heat conduction with heat generation. You know that so far I derived only uniform conductivity without heat generation, sorry, non-uniform thermal conductivity without generation. Two cases I have taken, one boundary condition and second boundary condition. I derived the equation for that also. Now we have to go for same slab with heat generation at the center. I'll write the figure. I'll make you understand how the boundary conditions for this case is considered. When the heat is getting generated at the center of the slab, look at the figure that I have given. If you take the slab of considerable thickness and at the center there is a heat generation. So this is the heat generation, and Qx is equal to, Q in x direction is equal to minus Ka dt by dx is the standard equation, Fourier's law of thermal conduction. Call this equation 3.1. You know that heat is getting generated at the center. You know that we are going to take from the center, we are measuring the axis. Coordinate 0 taken is at the center of the slab. You know the elemental thickness I am going to consider here. At x, this is dx, x from the center, and dx, this is delta x at the distance x from the center. The temperature distribution is maximum at the center, minimum at the wall, minimum of the both the side of the wall. You call this as temperature T1, this is also temperature T1, and here you will get T maximum because heat is getting generated at the center of the wall. When the heat is generating at the center of the wall, the maximum temperature do occurs here. It means suppose in the slab at center I put the heating coil. The temperature of the heating coil is known, that is T max. And this is the conduction heat flow through the slab with heat generation when the temperature of the both the side of the walls are same. It means T1, T2 are the same, but T max is there, and you have to find out the temperature distribution for this condition and also heat flow for this condition. Suppose the QG is the heat generated in the element and delta X into A, that is Q heat generated is what? This is the heat generated. I am using the three hats here. Heat generated is QG. QG is equal to Q dot into area. Area perpendicular to the board. Cross sectional area perpendicular to the board into the thickness delta X. This becomes the volume. You know that the rate of heat generation is always watt per meter cube. Unit for this is heat generation is watt per meter cube is the answer. Therefore, A into delta X is the volume and Q dot is the heat generation. Q triple dot I have taken here because different notation I used here now. And Q dot both are equal. Q dot is equal to Q triple dot R double dot and all are for our convenience we are writing that as heat generation. In some of the books he is using Q dot and Q triple dot. That is the never affect the any equation homogeneity. Heat conducted at a distance x plus dx can be written, and this is how the already given the Laplace equation and also the Poisson's equation. Poisson's equation is that d square t by dx square plus q dot k is equal to 0. This is the Poisson's equation for one dimensional second order differential equation. Okay, this I take an effort to derive by using the heat conducted from the left to right. See the Qx is the heat conducted to the left of the wall plus heat generated Qg is equal to heat conducted out Qx plus dx. And the same thing is again it is simplified to get the d square t by dx square plus of q dot by k is equal to 0. So you know that qx is equal to minus k dt by dx, you substitute q dot is equal to qg is equal to q double triple hat into a into delta x, you substitute here. And again Qx is equal to minus k dt by dx. Dx, q dx plus dx, x plus dx means minus, you know that minus k a double by d by dx of minus k dt by dx into delta x. That you have to substitute and then simplify it, finally you will get this equation. This is called Poisson's equation. Okay. So this Poisson's equation is made use to derive the temperature distribution equation for the condition like this. You can directly take this equation. You have to worry about this all this condition, but it is better to understand how this equation is derived for a single dimension. It means one dimension. This is how it's going to be taken. This is the Poisson's equation. Steady state Poisson's equation with heat generation. This is the differential equation controlling the heat flow by conduction when the body is generating heat. So that is equal to x. You know, you have to integrate the equation. Integrate this equation d square t by dx square plus of q dot by k is equal to 0. Integrating this equation with respect to x. So what do you get? Dt by dx plus of q dot by k you multiplied by x is equal to c1 you get. So integrating this once again you get t plus of q dot by k, this is x square by 2 is equal to c1 into x plus c2. This is what you get. C1x plus C2. So call this equation 1. This is the temperature distribution equation with a known heat generation source at the center of the wall. Now, using boundary conditions, you know that dt by dx at this point is 0 because temperature gradient at the point wall is remains 0 at x is equal to 0. It means there is no temperature gradient exists at this point. This is the minimum temperature and this is the maximum temperature. And temperature gradient at this point is 0. Dt by dx is 0. It means x is equal to 0 taken at the center itself. Therefore, the boundary conditions are dt by dx is equal to 0 at x is equal to 0. This is the first boundary condition in the above equation. If we substitute this, what do you get? X is equal to 0, this will get cancelled. This will get 0 and this also becomes 0. So, what do you get? Dt by dx. You can take directly here dt by dx is equal to. Dt by dx is equal to 0 if you put x is equal to 0, but c1 is equal to what? C1 is equal to 0, you get. C1 is equal to 0. Then second boundary condition is t is equal to t1. T is equal to t1 at x is equal to l by 2. Why do you take x is equal to l by 2? So the total length is l. Total length is l. Half of it is, half of this is l by 2. Total length is how much? This is L. Half of this is L by 2, L by 2. L by 2 plus L by 2 is L only. So that way you have to take. And X is equal to L by 2. Temperature T is equal to T1. Temperature T is equal to T1 at X is equal to L by 2 from the center. Look at it. From the center, L by 2 you have to take. Temperature T is equal to T1. And this is the boundary condition. Second boundary condition. This you have to substitute here and then calculate. What do you get? T1 is equal to Q dot by K. This is L square by 8 plus C1. This is equal to C1 is 0. 0 you have to put. C1 is 0. And C2 is what? You need to calculate C2. C2 value is this. We'll go to the next. Look at here. T1 Q dot by K plus L by 8 into C2 because L by 2 is equal to square this and 4 into A, 2 is 8 and L square you get. Okay. This is what you are going to get. Substituting C1, C2 in the above equation in order to get the appropriate temperature distribution condition. The final temperature distribution condition that I am going to get, T is equal to T1 half, T is equal to T1. You have to simplify this very, there is nothing big. You have to arrange this in the form Q dot L square by 8, L square by 8K multiplied by 1 plus of 1 minus of 2X divided by L whole square. This is only arrangement. This is not the equation you get. 2x divided by L whole square. This is the equation. When t is, for this condition, the value of t will be maximum when x is equal to 0. When x is equal to 0, value will become t is equal to t maximum. If you substitute this value here, what do you get? T maximum is t1, as it is you have to maintain, plus of Q dot L square divided by 8K. This is the equation. To know the center temperature, at the center temperature, by knowing the both the T1 and T2, you can directly, and also the thickness L by 2, you can directly calculate the what is the maximum temperature. If you are using a coil, coil temperature can be calculated by using this. It means why? This is a Reddy-Reckner equation. And if the slab is having a heat generation source at the center, you not have to put the probe to measure it. Only measure, you know this atmospheric temperature equal to the wall temperature. And knowing the T1 and amount of current, it means amount of power is supplied, by electric power is supplied, Q dot that's watt per meter square you can take, and that value and length is known, you can directly react at the maximum temperature at the center. This is the usefulness of this equation. This is the usefulness of this equation. This equation is also given in the data handbook. You can refer the data handbook for understanding this. But in the examination, if the derivation is asked to mentioning the boundary condition, you have to derive this equation. Otherwise, I am using the same equation with a different boundary conditions. I am just integrating, knowing the boundary condition, I am simplifying the equation to a known form. See, it means unknown quantity can be calculated with the known quantities by this suitable equation. For that, this type of derivation is required. A simplification of these boundary condition to a simplified equation is necessary. So the student will ask, why you have to do all this jugglery? It means by complex equation, why to simplify? You all studied this in the mathematics, but mathematics teacher failed to explain the practicality of this. Suppose I give the iron box coil is there. To know the temperature of the iron box coil at the center, if you know the thickness on both sides, if you know the thickness of the wall where the coil is placed, you can also calculate the maximum temperature at the center. And the wall temperature is known to you. You can also measure the wall temperature by thermometer or by, there are now the non-contact thermometers are available. Only by radiation you can measure it, or the surface temperature can measure it. The best example is the coronavirus. They are checking just by sending the light to their head, forehead, and they are checking the temperature. If the temperature is very high, then he is a false sick and he is suffering from fever. That is the indication. That you must have seen in TVs that these handheld thermometers are there to measure the temperature. Why you have to measure only the head only, not in the body? It means the highest energy absorbed by the energy or the generation is only in the head, because it consumes 90% of the energy to keep you active. It means your brain requires 90% of the energy that you are consuming. So that is how the temperature is also more. You can also create a model. It means modeling you have to create, and then temperature you can measure by the head. It means taking the head as a sphere, you can also do the boundary condition. That is again a complex situation, but in your syllabus it is not mentioned. You know, for the thermal reactors and other things, we are using these boundary conditions to measure the temperature. Okay, coming to the heat flow through the, find out the heat flow by Fourier's law of thermal conduction at x is equal to L by 2. You know dT by dx as x is equal to L by 2 already. You have taken this dT by dx, the boundary condition is known to you. That is, substituting, already it is there in that I given. So this equation, remember this equation from where I have taken. This equation is C1 only. Look at here, this is the equation C1. X is equal to L by 2 only I am putting. This is the boundary condition I am taking and putting the X is equal to L by 2, and then you are doing away with the dT by dx. So X is equal to L by, if you substitute in that equation, minus Q dot A L by 2 you will get. That you have to substitute in this equation. So Q is equal to minus K dT by dx. You know dT by dx plus of Q dot by K into X is there. X is equal to L by 2, that I substitute in this equation and taken to the right side, and is equal to C1. C1 value is substituted here and you will get this equation. Replacing dT by dx by this quantity, you will get the equation like this. You know that K is get cancelled and Q A dot L by 2. This is the half the volume into heat generation. A into L by 2 is half the volume of the slab. It means one side of the slab is taken, half volume. of the slab is taken. If this is the heat flow from one surface, it means the heat flow from one surface is calculated by Q is equal to A Q dot into L by 2. If on the heat is generated here and flowing through both the surface, then what you have to do? It should be multiplied by 2 only. QL, Q total is equal to 2Q. It means 2AL by 2 into 2 is ALQ dot. That is volume into heat generating capacity at the center of the slab. Therefore, it is concluded that heat generated is equal to heat conducted. Whatever the heat generated, it is get conducted. And this is the temperature profile in the decreasing direction. Temperature profile in the decreasing direction, and heat conducted is equal to heat generated. So this is the solution for slab with heat generation. Say for a steady condition, the heat, another boundary condition that I am going to take. For the same problem, another boundary condition. What is that another boundary condition talking about? There are 3-4 boundary conditions. Knowing the temperature on both the side is one condition. Knowing the temperature remains both the conditions same at the center is heat generation. And the wall is one side is insulated, other side is exposed to the atmosphere. These are all these 3 conditions we are going to imagine. Are the practically available boundary conditions also you can implement. And some of the nearest practical application boundary conditions you have taken. For a steady state condition, the heat conducted at x is equal to L by 2. You know that the one condition that I have taken, this wall is insulated. This is the wall. It is insulated at the one end is insulated. And TW, the wall 2. And this is the TW1, is the wall 1. This is the wall 2. And thickness is length I have taken, thickness L I have taken. When the amount of heat generated at the wall, when the insulated surface is taken, how the heat is conducted out at the other end of the wall, TW, this is by pure convection only. Heat conducted at x by steady state and if the L by 2 is taken and it is heat convected out. So this is another boundary condition that I am going to deal. And first of all, the previous condition what I am calculating is how the heat is going out of the wall. It is by pure convection only. So taking the convection boundary condition, that is HA T1 minus TA. This is HA minus T1. The same boundary condition, Q is equal to A dot. The previous, yet to complete that. This is the heat source and this is L by 2. And you consider this, after that I'll come to that. So here the heat is conducted out from the wall to the air. This is by convection. This is by convection. HA is the convective heat transfer coefficient. Or H, convective heat transfer coefficient of air. That is how the heat is conducted out from the wall. Suppose this is the wall. I'm standing near to the wall. How the heat is coming to the wall, right from this to here. It is by convection heat transfer by air. It means you should know the coefficient of the heat transfer, that is convective heat transfer coefficient, that is H into the square area of the air that you have to take, and the temperature difference, this is T1 and this is TA. Difference between these two temperatures you should know. Then you can equate that Q is equal to A Q dot L by 2 HA T1 minus TA, where TA is the atmospheric temperature of air, and substitute that in the again temperature distribution equation, you will get T1 is equal to TA Q dot L by 2 H. If you simplify this, you will get in terms of heat generation, temperature TA and T1, you can also know. Substituting this value in the temperature 3.6, again you will get one more boundary condition, one more temperature distribution equation. That becomes a very complex temperature distribution equation with a known atmospheric temperature. And that is not different from the previous
here L by 2K is the same equation you are going to get out of that. If the plate is considered as B, this is the heat generating and uniformly and insulated to one end, and other end is exposed to the, this is the condition. This condition I am going to get the insulated wall, and another end is exposed to the air. One more condition: if the plate is considered as shown in figure B, this is figure B, if the, which is also generating heat uniformly, it means the inside it is also generating heat and it insulated at the one end, other end is exposed. This is the temperature T1 and this is the atmospheric temperature. Then how the temperature distribution equation? Using same temperature distribution equation, we are going to make addition, taking x is equal to L by 2, you will get the same answer. The previously whatever the equation is there, let me check with the previously same equation, T1 Q dot L square T maximum. See, same answer you are going to get. This is 2 by H and here this is the equation. T max is equal to T1. Q dot L by 8 by K, same equation is there, but it is a having a different notations that you altogether are going to get. This is T1 Q dot L square 2K. Instead of T max, you will get T1 here. So this is what the different boundary condition. You have to go through the this condition. Because wall 1 and wall 2, why I marked is, one wall 2 is insulated, wall 1 is left free leg to the atmosphere, and is exposed to the atmosphere, where T is the atmospheric temperature. When the TA is considered, then you have to take the convective heat transfer of the existing air surrounding that wall. Okay. So, before going to some problem, solving some problem, I will take this one example. It is to be, the resistance is in series. Yesterday we were discussing resistance is parallel, you have to consider. Suppose, consider wall A, wall B, wall C and wall D. There are four walls are considered here, wall A and wall B, wall C, wall D. See, wall A and B are in series, wall A, C, D are in series, wall A, B, D are in series, but A, B, C, B are in parallel. Can you see that? Wall A and wall D are in series, but they are supported by wall B and C, they are parallel, but they are in series with the A and D. So, how do you write the resistance equation for this? The simple equation for resistance is in parallel. So, this is the A again, this is B, and this is C, and this is D. This is A, this is B, and this is C, and this is D. Suppose this temperature is T1, this temperature is T2, this is T2 again, T2 again, this is T3, this is also T3, this is also T3, and this is T4. You can assume any boundary conditions like this. It means here it is T2, here it is T2, here it is T2, T3, T3, T3. You can write the resistance for this. It means the thermal resistors are series and thermal resistance are in parallel. You have to write cross-sectional area, that is given 1 cm square. The perpendicular to the area exposed is cross-sectional area. AC has taken, okay, that is 1 cm square. Here the, in the problem he has given,
in two dimension, if you write, this is the condition A, B, C, area is given 1 cm².
It is he explained here like this. Look at the resistance is again L by KAB.
So this is the RA resistance, LA length of this slab. This is LA. Can you see this? LA is the length of this slab. This is LC is equal to LB, and this is equal to LD. So the LA divided by KA, conductivity in A, into area of that. So the resistance RA is marked. RB is again LB divided by KB into AB. Here also, the for C, this is RC is equal to LC KC into AC.
These are the resistance values I am writing.
RD is equal to LD divided by KD into AD. You know the temperature is 400 is given here. I am solving problem also. I am writing the resistance in series and parallel.
So now the known values are, you have to mark on this.
Distance of LA is 3 cm. This should be converted into meter, 0.03 meter.
The distance of C and B are LC is equal to LB is equal to 8 cm. This is equal to 0.08 meter. And also similarly, 5 cm is given for D. LD is equal to 5 cm. This is equal to 0.08 meters.
You should see that all the units should be expressed in meter. Watts per meter Kelvin is the constant for conductivity. H value is, the conductivity value is usually expressed as watt per meter Kelvin, and H value is watt per meter square Kelvin or degree Celsius. Here the constants are in meter. The units also should be converted into meter, and then appropriately to substitute in the suitable equation to calculate the answer. So this is how we have to take. So what he is given is, the outside temperature is given as 80. Here it is 80 degree Celsius. 400 degree Celsius and 80 degree Celsius is the other end. Both the ends are given. And what he is asking you to calculate? He is asking you to calculate the heat transfer through the composite wall. It means you have to calculate the Q value. Q is equal to question mark. So this is the resistance are in parallel. This combined resistance should be series with the A, slab A and slab D, that you have to calculate. So now, first you have to calculate the resistance RA. RA is 3 by length is 3 meter. He has taken in centimeter only. You can also convert that into meter later. So 3 by 100 by 150 into T, because KA is taken. LA 3 meter. Conductivity is also given. You look at the conductivity that he has given here. Conductivity of A is 150 watt per meter Kelvin, that he has taken, and he has converted that into probably into meter. Into area exposed is 1 cm², and 1 cm² is as it is, he has taken, and later he is converted into meters, 10 raised to minus 3. What is the unit for resistance? Resistance is degree Celsius per watt. Here
let me calculate again whether I am getting the same answer or not. By substituting these values, I let me calculate. RA is equal to LA is 0.03 meter. Conductivity is 150 watt per meter Kelvin, and area is length is in meter, and area is in meter centimeter square. 1 centimeter square can be 1 centimeter square area. How do you calculate 1 centimeter? So this divided by 100 into 100. This comes to be meter square. It means 10 raised to minus 4. 1 meter square into 10 raised to minus 4. What do you get? So this is multiplied by 1 into 10 raised to minus 4. If you calculate suitably, you will get 0.2 into 10 raised to minus 3, I think. No, I have not calculated, but need to check this minus 150 is there again. You have to deduct that in that. You calculate and check RB and RC also. So this is all the unit conversion you have to take and then calculate it. But unit conversion should be appropriately substituted. Otherwise, you end up with the wrong answer and finally, you may not get the correct answer. So this is what I'd like to communicate to all the students. So next class I'll continue because the time is up already, and I'll continue with these small problems, resistance in series, resistance in parallel. This problem we're going to complete in the next class. And also I saw previously whatever the derivation I have done. If you are having data and book, next class I'll make an effort to bring data and book, and I'll show which page, what equation is given, how you have to refer to make yourself simplified and understand the equations which are given in the suitable format. Maybe a different notation used, but the equation, the content of the equation remains the same. Unit remains the same, but in this different format you must have given. But you should understand and the concept very clearly and fundamentals very clearly, then it is easy for you to refer the data handbook. And it is looks very simple if you understand. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult for you to understand. With this, I will wind up the class today. Thank you for patient hearing.